Mel Disselkoen, everyone. He's the guy that... He's not really going to start the probe yet, but, you know, I figured, well, you know, we need to get something, but everybody's standing around looking like, well, you know, they look at the clock, then they look back up at me, so just to give you a heads up on what we're going to be doing.
Crowd shot.
Yeah.
Well, I can just kind of talk in general here to start with, and normally, when I get to a group like this, I just kind of like to find out what your question is. I like to address your questions instead of just lecture and then go away with it. Is there anything, and of course I've addressed a couple of them already, the best I know how, and is there any questions that really are on anyone's mind?
Hey, Mel, how you doing?
Good.
In the spring, when you do the cuts for your queen cells, how early?
Okay, that's different to everybody in different locations. And in Michigan, our swarming starts about May 10th, okay? Always do your pulling the old queen out 1 week before swarming naturally starts in your area. Okay, 1 week. Because you've got to be consistent with nature. If you do it too quick, you're not going to have sexually mature drones 14 days or so later, 15 or, you know, when that virgin starts flying. They have to have sexually mature drones, otherwise you're not going to get a mated queen. But if you wait too long, that hive will swarm, and then you kept bees all year, and then have them swarm out, and that you lost your production that year. So you can't wait. And I was telling a beekeeper here tonight that I don't know if I ever had a swarm in probably the last 30 years. I've had mating flight swarms, and that's a completely different thing. But I'm talking about an overwintered queen. I just will not allow it. Okay? I'm not going to keep bees all year, get them through the winter, and then lose half that hive to a swarm. Okay? So a week before swarming starts in your area, what would that be? Here, middle of April?
10 days before that.
Yeah, 1 week before that. Take the old queen out because what you're really doing with that hive, it's an artificial swarm. You took the old queen, two frames of brood, that is a swarm. That's an artificial swarm done at your time, your way, at your convenience. Okay? You swarm that hive artificially. You didn't let the old queen go with half the bees. You let the old queen go with two frames of brood. Okay? Then you can notch, and if you want to notch for starts, you notch all the brood frames that are left. And usually there's around six or seven. Because 1 week before swarming, I'll have probably 8 frames of brood. Sometimes I'll have a hive that will have 12. Well, then you can make 6 starts. Okay? 2 brood frames in each start. Okay? If you want to produce honey, you can pull that old queen out and then only notch 1 frame in that parent colony, okay? Because you don't want to divide that hive. Strong hives produce the most honey, and what I found is it takes about 100 pounds of honey to produce brood for 1 month. That's an incredible amount of honey. And if you take a full-strength colony, remove the old queen, notch 1 frame, and if you've got good flying weather, okay, in the spring where the swarms would normally happen, that hive is capable of producing 100 pounds. By the time that queen emerges, that virgin emerges, and start laying. And usually you can get more than what your state average is by operating a hive that way. Okay? Any other question?
What do you mean by notching?
Yeah, we're talking about notching on the OTS, and this is what I've been doing to raise queen cells where novice beekeepers can raise their own cells. It's called on the spot, OTS, where I go into a hive after I remove the old queen. When you remove that old queen, that hive is already a cell builder. It's queenless. It's a cell builder. You just notch 36-hour or younger larva and I'll have slides for that. And then the difference is, if most bees want to raise queen cells on the edge of the bottom of the frame, and Miller's frame, that's how Miller did it, okay, too. They won't normally produce a queen cell on the face of a vertical comb, but they will if you notch it. Okay, you change the behavior toward that larva by notching it to the foundation, bend it down about a half inch, and the bees will change their behavior toward that larva. They'll raise it as a queen now instead of as a worker. And it's perfect queens because of the right age. And bees will never accept a larva too old. If you give bees larva of all ages to take a choice from, they'll always pick a two-day-old larva. They'll never pick a larva too old. Okay? Dr. C.C. Miller said that in 50 years among the bees, he's never seen them pick a larva too old. In 40 years, I haven't either. They just won't accept it. Now, you can force bees to do it if you give them larva too old. Okay, then, and if they don't have any other choice, they'll try to raise a queen, just on a survival thing. But bees will never pick a larva too old. Every cell you get will be perfect cell. Okay, so when you go back a week later, all the cells you see on that thing will be a perfect queen cell.
What if it is where you go in there, there's already some queen cells being built?
If there's queen cells being built, and you might not hardly even find the old queen, she might have already left for the swarm. Mm-hmm. As soon as that first cell is sealed, usually the queen will get out of there. I have, of course, gone into hives where there were cells. Then I do the best I can, and I just divide them right up there.
Oh, okay.
You see what I mean? And I don't even worry about the old queen there. Okay, if she's in there, then she's in there. Okay, what I mean? And another thing about starts, once I do a start, it's either a success or a failure. And if it's a failure, I never unite it back to a good start. Okay? Because the purpose of this is to break the mite breeding cycle. And if you don't, if you have a failure on your start and you unite it back to a good one, that start now reinfests the good one because it didn't break the mite breeding cycle. It's either a success or a failure, and I just let that start die out. What I'll do is I'll let it go until it's got a laying worker, okay, where I can see it's got a laying worker. I'll leave one frame that's got the larva of the laying worker, and I'll shake all the bees in that hive, and I'll leave that one frame there. So that laying worker stays right there. All these other frames now are good. I can give those up. There's no bees on it. Just that drone brood that laying worker did, and I'll give them the good hives, okay? And I let the laying worker hive starve out. I just sacrificed one comb in there. You see, I just let the laying worker stay on the original stand and just let it die out. I don't try to ignite that failure. Okay. Anything else?
I done something real similar early this spring. It was just by accident, but I actually found two queens in one swarm. So okay, I thought they were getting ready to swarm, so I pulled both queens out, made two splits with it, and then 3 or 4 days later, come back to the original hive, and they had built several queen cells. So, okay, they're queenless. And then with that, when the queen cells, the first queen emerged, they swarmed. Do you have trouble with that, or is that rare, or is that a fluke?
No, that's normal, because once they start raising queen cells on their own, they've got that swarming impulse. It's hard to knock that out of them. They want to continue to do the swarming, okay? This is why I do a week before swarming starts in your area, because they don't start that swarming impulse, okay? Then they'll settle right in and do what you want them to do.
So I thought I was doing right.
Well, you
I
did.
Mean, they just started, you know, and there was like two or three swarms, and one day there was another swarm, and then the next day there was, you
they
know.
They kept raising cells because they had that swarming impulse.
Okay.
The only way to stop that would be to take one or two frames, just divide it up where you see your cells. You see, kill everything but two cells per start, and just let them go.
They had like eight or nine of them in there, I've left them, and then.
Another thing is I only allow two cells on a start. Sometimes I'll have six, eight cells on a frame, But then all of that virgin's got to kill all those other virgins in the cells. That takes way too much effort. Why should you allow that virgin to do that when you can smash all but two? I'll let her kill one. That's normal. You see what I mean? But I want her to remain to have her strength for her mating play, not trying to kill all the virgins in the hive.
What date did we determine for our area to pull the queen out then?
Well, then I think you're about the middle of April, aren't you, down here? For
middle of April, like April 5th.
What is it, Gary?
Well, sometimes it's even earlier than that.
Yeah. You gotta get to your local bee club and find out when the swarming is, and then a week before swarming starts, that's when you want to do that.
We usually catch a swarm probably about the first week in April, and that's when I start setting up our swarm traps.
Okay,
also.
Well, then maybe the last the last week in March already, you can do that. See, here's the thing. Here's nature. Okay, we're dealing with nature. I never fight with my bees. I always work with nature according to their behavior and their characteristics. They want to swarm. That's what bees do in the spring. So if I do that a week before swarming starts, I'm within the envelope. You see, and so they want to do what I'm directing them to do.
Do you recommend watching for drones? Because, I mean, obviously you don't want to start raising queens before you've got drones that are
there are plenty of drones. Don't worry about that.
Don't sweat
the drones. A mating place sometimes can go 15 miles. Right. A lot of people think it's just going to be in the neighborhood. But there's drone congregation areas, okay? And that drone congregation area can consist of maybe 100 different hives and 100 different beekeepers. Their drones come into that drone congregation area. So there's absolutely no way you're going to control that drone breeding, the breeding area. You're not going to control the concern. Okay, you just, to me, you breed from your survivors, the overwinter survivors. And if you keep breeding from the bees in your own yard, you've got bees that are the bees you want. Because they already proved that they were successful. I tell people that we all have the same objective. Okay, we're all trying to produce better bees and keep them alive. Okay, so how we arrive at that can be different. Okay, every beekeeper is like a farmer, and there's a little different method or whatever they want to do. So I don't ever try to tell anybody how to keep bees. But I will say this, and I use this as an example a lot. Years ago, I'm talking 30, 40 years ago, I guess I'll tell you that I'm a barber by trade. Okay, I've been barbering 50 years. Next year will be my 50th year. And I met everybody. Okay, sooner or later they're going to walk in that shop. And I have, it's kind of a blessing. It's the type of education that I don't know if anybody else can really get. But what I'm getting at is everybody thinks differently and everybody has a little different perspective of how to do things. And if you take 100 people and gave them a 500-piece puzzle, all identical, put them in a small room and say, make the puzzle. All 100 of those will approach that puzzle from a different perspective, or a different start point. Some will do the size, some will do the color, some will do the printing, whatever. But the finished product is always the same. And so I use that as an example. Everybody here is unique. Okay, so I want you to understand that. Another thing that I learned is that, I'll use this as an example, and it talks about points of view. Everybody has a different point of view in life. And I was talking to this gentleman, and he was talking about this two-story aluminum walkout at the end of this Baldwin Street. And he says, well, I know where Baldwin Street is, but that's not a two-story aluminum walkout, that's a red brick ranch. And he says, no, I mean the one on the end, on the right side, way on the end. I says, yeah, I've been there many, many times. That's a red brick ranch. He says, Mal, that's a red brick ranch from the front. But that's a two-story aluminum wall house on the back. Okay? It all depends on your point of view. Okay, now if you're tunnel vision, you're only going to see it your way. You're only going to see things from your perspective and your point of view. But you sometimes have to walk around the house. And I try to see it from everybody's point of view. Or, you know, another thing, a person doesn't know what he doesn't know. Okay? I don't know what I don't know. Back in the 50s, the smartest 4.0 electrical engineers at MIT didn't have a clue what a computer was. They didn't know what they didn't know. And we're all going to learn in the future, and we're all going to... I built on what Doolittle and Miller did 100 years ago, and people here are going to build on what I've been doing. So it's just a progress. We're all in this together, and we don't really care who solves this problem as long as we can keep our bees alive again and be successful. So with that type of introduction, I'd like to get going on... if we can turn the lights down maybe just a little bit.
Is that enough?
If you can see it, okay, it's enough. I'm going to be speaking this Saturday at Turkey Run, and I decided that basically my message has always been the same. There might be some other pictures in there and other questions in that, but we'll be going through this at Turkey Run too. I've got quite a few slides that we can go through fast. Some of it we might have to take a little time. The biggest problem that I have noticed with groups, new groups, is they don't understand the gestation of the honeybee. And there's a chart. Gary got a wonderful chart there. And we'll be going through that a little bit, okay? But you have to understand how long it takes for a queen, 16 days, a worker 21 days, and a drone 24. The egg is always 3 days, and the open sealed cells is always 5 days. I don't care if that's a worker or a queen or a drone. Those are exact. Okay. Now, the royal mite will always go in the cell the day before it's sealed, which would be the 8th, 9th day. Okay, and that's a weak spot in the varroa's biological makeup, because that's where we can really hit that varroa mite and give it a huge road bump. Okay, and you have to know that when a queen emerges, it's going to take 2 weeks to have a mated queen. By the time she goes out, mates, comes back, and starts developing a brood nest, so it's going to be 30 days. When you do your notching, actually you've taken day 5, so you've already got 5 days. Another 11 days, the virgin will emerge, and then another 14 days. So you got 5 and 11, you're at 6, 16, and then another 14, so you're already at 30 days. Okay, so that's what it's going to take. And that's what I'm talking about. You got that 30-day window. If you only notch one frame and you're running for honey, you can have 100 pounds of honey in there at the end of that month, because they have no open brood to feed, no brood to feed at all, except for the first few days when everything gets sealed.
We've got a lot of new people here tonight. For those of you that don't know, the restrooms, you go straight through the garage into the house. It's the first door on the left. Pop the water in the fridge, the bathroom's in the house. Other than that, Mel's got all the answers.
Okay. That's a very important thing to know. Okay, what I call this, people will ask me, because they go to my website and they talk about the IMM system of queen rearing. And now they talk about the OTS. Okay, what's the difference between the IMN and the OTS? Well, when I did all my research and I did my wrote my book and I printed that in 1988, it was the IMM system of queen marine. I basically gave all the research data to get where I could produce queens wherever I want them, okay, at my convenience on a comb. The OTS is exactly the same thing, only now I've made the transition to your bee yards. You can use that old IMN now, the concepts that I presented in that book in 1988, now to raise quality queens. And these queens are free, by the way, because you're using your own bees and you've got good quality queens. So all of these queens are free. So I dispatch a lot of queens because I keep breaking the mite's breeding cycle. And people say, well, how can you do that? And to me, the queen is free, okay? And I break the mite's breeding cycle so I keep the hive alive. They don't die out to the varroa. And my concept of beekeeping is that even though the queen is very, very important, I don't see her as the royalty that there is written in the books. Okay? The colony is an entity. It's got guard bees, it's got nurse bees, it's got comb builders, it's got foragers, it's got all these different bees doing these different jobs. Any job that isn't done, the hive dies. So nurse bees are just as important as the queen. Okay, all what the queen is a niggling machine. That's all she is. She don't make any decisions, she don't make anything, the bees just feed her to produce eggs for her ovary. The queen don't decide when to swarm, the bees just withdraw food from her to get her slimmer into the swarming. There's what I call control bees in a hive, okay? And that's the way the hive operates. So my July start queens that overwinter live for a full year because they were started in July, they made it in August, they took the colony through the winter. In the spring, I pulled her out, made that artificial swarm out of her, okay? And then in July, now I never broke the mite breeding cycle on her yet, because she could outbreed the mites until July. Then that's my breeding stock. That queen lived 1 year as my breeding stock because she'll have 8 frames of brood by the 1st July, okay, and I'll make 4 splits out of that. And all I have to do is overwinter one of those 4, and I got my same hive count. I started with 1, and I'll end up with 1. But I've been overwintering 3 out of those 4. So I've been making increase even over through the winter. Okay. The other hive, how you want to do it in the spring, if you want to do it for honey production, and you notch it in the spring, you can produce your honey. Or you can notch all the frames, make 3 splits out of that. And then I sell those splits. Okay, I take my $300 a hive, plus I got the old queen for my replacement bees. Okay, now, if you don't sell them, I can emerge all 3 of those hives the 1st of July and run it for a honey flow. Because in Michigan, that's when our major honey flow is in July. Or each one of those queens now in the month of June, when they first start mating in June, will have 6 frames of brood. I can make 3 more July starts out of each one of those. So I can make 9 starts there off my July queens, plus the 4 I'm going to make out of the overwinter queen, so I can produce 13 starts out of that hive this year. Okay, so basically I could sell $1,300 worth of bees out of that one hive. Okay, and my fiscal year starts then in July. Most people in this room, their year starts in the spring. I start my year in July, that's when I'm breaking up my overwinter queen from a breeding stock for the next year. Okay, I have to admit I'm a different type of a beekeeper. Most beekeepers here will run for honey production or pollination. Okay, I have never done that. I'm less than 1% probably, because I love to see bees draw comb. I like to see queen cells being drawn out, and I like to see new starts taken off. That's where I am in beekeeping. So, and everybody can make modifications to this, but the point is, how can you raise your own queens free, quality, and overwinter, and you can work that into your management. So, I spent a little time there getting the difference between IMN and OTS. It's the same thing. Okay. Dr. C.C. Miller, he tried to produce queens without grafting, and he developed that frame there on the side there. And when he gave that to a queenless hive, they would produce queen cells on the edges. Dr. C.C. Miller could never figure out why they just did it on the edge. He would trim those cells after they were drawn out, because natural behavior of a honeybee, they'll never put a cell on the face of a vertical comb. They won't do it unless it's a supersedure cell, okay, of the old queen. I discovered that it's not the edge at all. When he trimmed the comb, he had inadvertently had broken the cell wall below the young larva. Okay, he had removed the cell wall below the young larva, and that's why they produce queen cells. And G.M. Doolittle, he invented grafting. Okay, he's the one who contributed to the grafting, and excellent beekeeper from Syracuse, New York. I've taken now those two disclosures from those guys. And Doolittle also started new starts by 7 day old sow or brood that was over a support colony. And I'll go into a graph of that, and that's the same concept I use. When you notch, then a week later you come back, they've already got the queen cells, because I said there's 5 days of open brood, and when you take a 2 day old larva and start, they've already got that cell sealed 3 days later. So when you go back a week later, okay, all the larva in that hive is sealed. Except 1 day, but that's so close, because it said 3 days in the egg, 5 days in the open larva. If you do that, you can come back 7 days later, there's a chance that, you know, there's maybe a day or a half a day that larva isn't sealed in that one,
on the one egg that was laid, the last egg that queen had laid.
Okay, this is an important point. In the 70s when I started, there was queen breeders all over the place. Okay, you know, and we had wild colonies all over the place. We had a tremendous gene pool all over, okay. Now, back in 2010, we've got queen breeders now probably less than maybe 200, maybe 150, and we have no wild bees to speak of anymore. So, my concept to maintain the gene pool is everybody in here now has got to do their own queen rearing with the OTS, okay? Get your own stock and keep that gene pool wild. It's very hard to produce bees to improve the bee stock. Very, very difficult. Honeybees, realize this, but honeybees is the only organism I know of that got that kind of a reproductive system. Okay, usually you have a sire and a dam, whether it's race horses or Holstein cattle or dogs, okay? That's the way you have a father and a mother. But the honeybee don't operate that way. They have a mother, but they can have 15 different fathers in that hive. Okay, so you don't know what you're grafting from, and that's why it's so difficult to improve honeybees, unless you can do it on islands or isolation or by instrumental insemination. It's almost impossible to improve the honeybee. All your races were developed by geographic isolation. Your Italians, your Carniolans by the Alps, even the Africanized bee in Africa. Honeybees are population bred. They're bred from survivors, okay? And this is the concept that a lot of queen breeders are starting to understand now, where they like to say, I got Italians, I got hygienic, or I got this and that. Well, you may have, but the first mating on the virgin, you're 50% diluted already. You see, you can't maintain it, you see. And I don't even know if they know what they had in the first place, because I got yellow queens that'll produce black virgins when you notch them. So I think if a bee's yellow, it's an Italian, and if it's black, it's a Carniolan or a Caucasian. And the way the American beekeeping industry is set up, it's on wheels. They take 100,000 colonies to Amiens in California and to Florida. And how in the world can you keep anything straight? My bees are mutts, okay? And people ask me, what's the best bee there is in the world? And I said, alive. Okay, and that's the way I handle that. The enormity of the gene pool, that shows you. I mean, you can control the maternal, but you can't control the paternal. I used to graft. Okay, when I first started, I used to graft, and I was pretty good at it. Okay? But now, ever since the 80s and stuff, and I started doing the research on the IMN, that notching is the way I produce things. Now, I said you have to know the gestation, and I try to make a simple example here. You have to know that. The egg is laid, and 3 days later it goes into a larva, open larva for 5 days, okay? On day eight, all cells are sealed, including the queen cells, and that's also when the fertile varroa mite will go into that brood cell the day before it's sealed. Now, every varroa mite you see in your hive is a fertile female. She's already been fertilized in the cell before she's merged. Okay, so she's fertile. Okay, so every varroa mite that you have in your hive is a fertile female. Okay, waiting for an 8-day open cell just before it's sealed. Now, when you take the queen away, there's a period there where you're broodless. And then when the new queen starts laying a month later, she'll all of a sudden get the 8-day old open larva. Okay, now all those roles were on those bees, and they had no place to lay any eggs. Okay, now all of a sudden, you're going to provide a medium for her. 5, 6, 10 varroa mites can all run into the first 500 cells that will reach day 8 of that new mated queen. That's an overload. Okay, they'll go in there. They'll suck the blood out of the bees will seal the cell. They'll suck the blood out of the hemolymph of the larva. They'll exhaust it. The larva will die, and so will all those mites. They self-destruct. It's a biological self-destruction. Okay, and that's a weakness in the varroa mite, and that's how I break the mite's breeding cycle. I don't want to eradicate it. I just get it to a point now where that new queen can outbreed those mites again, and we can take care of it without miticides. Okay, I don't give miticides. I want to make that real clear. I haven't given miticides for varroa or trachea. but I've been able to keep this under control by breaking my breeding cycle. I can't say I'm chemical free because I do treat terramycin and fumigellin B. I think those are antibiotics. They've been around for 40 years. The bees haven't been able to get resistance to them, or they would have. I think it's an excellent product. Terramycin, of course, the fall brood. And I don't have much fall brood because I've always got young, I got good comb. Okay, but I think Nosema is a big problem, especially when your bees are getting stressed out. And we'll talk a little bit, too, of how they get stressed out. And I think Varroa can stress them a little bit. And we'll go for that. I kind of covered most of that on day 24, because that's the drone cycle. All the and drones will carry Varroa. On day 24, all brood, including drones, have emerged. On day 30, the new queen now is mated. And then on day, like I say, whenever that 8 day is of that new queen's brood, the Varroa will get hit. And there, it's the same thing. It's possible for bees to still raise queens 5 days later than the notching, because you're notching 2 day old larva. If an egg was just laid, it's going to be 3 days, and then it can go another 2 days. So I have already taken my starts, okay, and I see an open queen cell, just ready to be sealed. That's completely normal, because they took a cell builder will continually raise queen cells. They take grafts in and grafts out, whatever. So they want to raise queens because they're queenless. So that's not a problem. So instead of checking 30 days, or you know, which would be normal for a queen to be mated, I'd give her another week, because it could have been that 5 day old, the egg that they raised that queen cell from. A lot of people says it's a failure. I says, give it another week. I call them back, oh, Mel, she's laying great. She was there all the time. If you would have mated that hive, you would have lost it. You see what I mean? So okay, and this is on the website. You've probably seen this. It's the same thing, the gestation period and how that mite is broken. Okay, we talked about Miller a little bit before, and I already mentioned that. Give them a larva of all age and which to select, and they always choose one that's two days old or younger. I have never seen bees start a cell after the larva was too old. Another thing, if you can't find 2 day old larva, and I'll explain what to look for, you can notch eggs. Okay, they might still take 2 day old larva, and that virgin will kill the ones on the eggs. But I've known people that I couldn't find any larva males, but I just did the eggs. Well, that works also. Okay, now when an overwinter queen, normal overwinter queen, she'll start, and even if it has mites in the spring, well, I'll breed the mites. Bees with mites can get to a swarming pitch. They can outbreed the mite, okay? But usually in August in Michigan, the old queen starts slowing down in egg laying, where the mites kept on going, okay? So that's when the Varroa will take over and kill a hive, usually in the fall. But with the OTS queen that I did in June there now, if it was after June 21, which is the summer solstice, okay, that bees operate by sun and by orientation to the sun. Okay, bees can sense that now days are getting shorter. Okay, when you make that start, okay, and Doolittle dwelt on this in his book. Okay, the only way to get a fall queen to act like a spring queen is with a queen cell and a virgin queen after, he didn't say the summer solstice, but he talked about it's normal for honeybees to supersede their queens in July. That's when they normally do it. And they and there's more supersedure than you think happen. You think that you don't, they, you still got the old queen that's 3 years old. Well, unless she's marked, and she might not be, she might be a supersedure queen, okay? And so, but with the OTS advantage, that hive does not shut down in the fall. I got brood right on through October in Michigan, okay? That queen don't quit laying. Okay, she acts just like a spring queen. So I go into winter with less bees, maybe 5-6 frames of bees in a single, but they're all young 20-year-old females. Young bees, all young bees. Whereas if you go in with full-strength older hives, they slow down and you have older bees. And I have to say something about that too, because the hives are completely different. They act different, they respond different. The physiology of the hive is different. You know it's a July start, and I know it's a July start, but that July start doesn't know it's a July start. Because those starts will come out full strength in the spring. If you feed them properly, you'll have three pounds of bees in March, and they'll just act like a package that was hived in March. You see, they'll just go. Okay, contemporary method of splitting. Now, these migratory beekeepers that go down to Florida, what they do is when they make splits, they'll take a hive, they'll go into a hive, and say it's got 8 frames of brood. They'll just go in there, they don't look for the queen at all. All what they do is they put 4 boxes and they stack them up 4 high. Okay? And the brood is in frames 4 or 5. Okay, right on up. Because bees are chimney. Okay? Now the queen can be in any one of those 4 boxes. They don't even look for her. Okay, the very next morning, they do a whole yard like that and get it set up. The very next morning they go in there with their bee trucks and their pallets, they set them on the ground, and all what they do is move the boxes on the bottom board, you know, on the pallet, okay, and give it a cover. Okay, so it's a real fast, quick operation. They got 2 frames of brood in each box. Okay, so now they move that 2 miles away, let them set for maybe a day or maybe even 4 or 5 hours, and then they'll go back and they'll put a queen cell on each one, even the one that's got the queen. You see, so they might waste the queen cell or whatever, but the time element is so important to them. That's how contemporary queen rearing is done. And I've done that down in Florida many, many times helping people. Okay, so it's fast, it's quick, and it's accurate. Okay, so we talk about 2 brood frame splits, and this is what I basically am going to talk about on a novice level. This is Doolittle's approach. Doolittle produce comb honey, okay? And one-fifth of the hives were support colonies, 4/5 of the hives were comb producers, okay? And what Doolittle did was he take the old queen and a frame that maybe half full of brood and put it on the bottom. And Doolittle had reserve comb, okay? And then he would shake all those bees in front. Okay, so they would all run in, and then you put an excluder on and super it. Okay, and any honey in those combs on the bottom, because bees won't allow honey in the brood nest, is right away put right up into those sections, okay, in the honey flow. The queen lays in that bottom box, and it just fills up the top of sections. So now you got boxes of beeless brood, because you shook all the bees off that brood. Then he had a support hive, okay? He gave that to a support hive. Now, most beekeepers don't understand that, but bees can take care of 3 times more brood than they have. Okay? That seems like it's hard to believe. He could put those empty brood boxes, beeless brood boxes, on top of the support colony. And because say he had 100 hives. 20 of them would be the support colonies, and he'd have 20 section producing hives here. So that means 80 boxes had to be put on 20 hives. Okay, so he was doing 4. I said 3, just to err on the safe side. Okay, that's how Doolittle did it. Then Doolittle, a week later, would come back because he started grafting. He would have his queen cells in his other yard now. Then a week later, he would go and take each box and put it on a bottom board because there was no more open brood in the box. It was a week later. There's no open brood. Okay, and then he'd give them a ripe queen cell. Okay, and that's how he would make 80 splits plus his section producing hive. Fantastic. And this is how I do it. Same concept, only I'm uniting now Miller and Doolittle. Okay, so I go to an overwinter colony that's got 8 pairs of brood. I pull the old queen out, and I move her 2 miles away because she's got open brood. Then I notch all 6 cells that are left, or 6 frames that are left. Okay, I only want cells on 3 frames. Sometimes I get cells on all 6. But I only need cells on 3 of the 6 because I'm going to make 3 2 brood frame starts out of that. A week later, all that larvae is sealed. So all what I got to do now is take 2 brood frames. If I only leave 2 cells on each start, break down all the other cells, and you can leave them in the same yard there because you took all the stress off the colony. Like I said earlier, strong colonies always do the best work, okay? They produce the most honey, they do the best work. So I had the full-strength colony produce the cells, I had the full-strength colony seal all the brood, and so I took all the stress out of that little start. That's already been done. Now when you move it over, all they gotta do is incubate the brood that's already sealed. I took all the work, all the hard work away from that little start. Just excellent beekeeping, but that's what Doolittle did. So it's not all my thinking, it's what was done 100 years ago already, and I just kind of enhanced it where we can use it now to raise our own queens free in the same process without getting into all that grafting and grafting houses and what I call the tinker toy of queen rearing. There's always too many parts. You see, all your kits too, you know, that you buy. Just way these tinker toys is to me. You know, just too many parts, you lose this and lose that, and this way you just notch and you got it done. Okay, this is what I'm talking about, how to make the most of your honey flow. Okay? We're producing now, we pulled the old queen out, and we moved it. Okay, now we got 6 frames of brood. Okay, so I only notch 1 frame. I only notch 1 frame there, okay? A week later, I make sure there's no more cells. There could be cells on those others because there were 6 frames of brood. So I only keep 2 cells on this 1 frame. So 1 week later now, all this is sealed. And like I just told you, bees can take care of 3 times more brood than they have. So now what I do is I got my 3 frames of brood, 1 with a queen cell on it, and 3 frames of brood on the bottom, and right above it, I got 3 frames of brood on top. And in between now, I put frames of foundation. Okay, now when I sell bees in the spring, I can take $1.50 frame with foundation in, and when I sell my nuke, I can get $6 for that frame. Okay, now this is during the honey flow now, or spring swarming, so these bees are producing wax involuntarily. It's not taking any honey away. Whenever there's a honey flow, they'll produce wax. And because bees want their brood nest intact, they'll draw this comb out overnight, pretty much overnight. Okay, so I can pick up another $30 worth of frames plus whatever honey I can get out of that hive. And it's still a spring start, because when she lays, starts laying, it's just like a start. Just like I would have notched all, you know, different starts. So that's, I put red little lines there about the larva that's about the right age to notch.
I didn't see it.
Can you see that okay? Can you see the larva in the cells? They're too old, they're too big. When you go into a hive and you see a path, the white on the bottom of the bottom of the cell, the egg, when it hatches, the larva are mass fed with royal jelly for the first 36 hours. It's neither a worker or a queen. This is the spring of 2011. The bees or the trees aren't even broke out yet, but we're making a, this is what, first of May, where we're making our, this is a week before swarming starts. Okay, this is what I'm going to pull the old queen. That's the candy board. You can see that they took a cleansing flight, and there's a half inch hole there in that candy board. Okay, and in March or so, I put a little pollen patties in. And there's, okay. Quick question. How? I use that because the only reason I use it, that's what that hive looks like, and that hive has six rings of brood already. And you notice the comb is clean. I sell so many nukes. Back to that honey-producing hive like that, if you want to extract that honey, okay, you can separate the foundation honey that's in the honey and the honey that's in the old combs. So if you just want to extract the old combs, that's a good way to call your old combs too, if you got bad comb. Okay. Okay, I have raw. Everybody has raw. If you don't have raw, you don't know what to look for. Okay, I have a little black spot there on that bee's raw mite. Okay, and but it's such a limited deal that I can say it's tolerable. There's a frame that I'm talking about. Hell, it's probably a honey frame that I talked about and I put in the middle of the brood nest. Okay, that's solid. There's, if we go eight inches down and 16 across, and there's 25 cells per square inch, there's about 3,200 worker cells on that one side of that frame, and that's a pound of bees. Okay, she's as good as you can get it. There's another one, there's a shadow there. That's probably one of the older combs, maybe a couple years old, but even the top are clean, you see what I mean? Honey in the corner, in this corner. That's hard to see, but there's a queen. Can you see her thorax right here? And she's got her abdomen in a cell, she's laying an egg. Right when I'm working her, working the hive, she's still laying. Removing overwinter queens, two cranes of brood, two shakes of bees. This, you've seen my splitter boxes. They're the cardboard splitter boxes. Well, years ago, I made the same splitter box with corrugated plastic. Okay, that's a corrugated, it's the same design, same everything. They were too expensive to sell, people weren't buying them. I had about 1,000 made. I use them all the time, okay, because I can make queens out of it. And when I sell my bees, they go in the cardboard. I just transfer them into the cardboard and put them in. That's what I'm talking about, notching with the end of my hive tool. I put it right in there. There's larva there, you see what I mean? put the hive through right in, almost go to the larva. Don't touch that larva, and then just bend it down a half inch.
Are you doing just one or multiple cells?
I get 8 at a time. You see, now some of them might be too old, but these ones, I'll identify larva I want, and I'll just get one and do it. If I get one or two off that, I'll probably do two of those on each side of that cell. All what I want is two cells on that frame anyway. You see what I mean? Because
when I've done this procedure, I have found that on the old cones, that they prefer, you know, like if you're going through a hive and you've got like 10 frames of pressure on the top, and you mark those, and then you mark the ones in the bottom by marking them from breaking the cell wall down. And they prefer the new cone.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, 2-1.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, I don't care where they produce them. See what I mean? But you're right. And they're harder to knot because you got a cocoon in.
Right.
You see what I mean? That virgin comb up there, if they got larva in there, it's just a piece of cake. You know, but if they got cocoon in there or older comb, you know, you got to get in there and get it just right. Like that's a little older comb. Hey, you see how I'm breaking that bottom third of that cell wall? Now, they would not produce a cell there, but by doing that, I change the behavior toward that larva. Okay, and that's what the enhancement of the Miller method was. Okay, and here's a frame. There's 6 nice cells on there. One, two, three, four, five, and 6. And you can see right here is probably where I took that hive tour. Now there may be 6 on the other side of that frame too. You see what I mean? But when you make the start, you smash them all except 2.
Are the bees moving those eggs after you notch them? They're taking them out and put them
in there? No. They're raising that cell right there.
Right there where you notched it?
Right where I notched.
So you notched that frame in 6 places?
I notched that frame like I showed you, the picture before. Mm-hmm.
In 6 places?
That's a week later, 7 days later.
Now, another thing, I've found that, whenever you mark one side, and then you go around, and there's about the same age larva on the opposing side.
Yeah.
She lays here a while and goes clear to the other side.
And another thing, too, you can sometimes go to a hive and there's frames, like I showed you, that there are no available larvae to notch. You see, this is why you only need 3 out of the 6. You see, it raises 7. And there are some bees that have different characteristics. Some bees are better cell builders than others. Okay? Some I could have 14, 15 cells. The other ones, boy, I barely eat, just kept 4 or 5. And sometimes I'll keep the comb out. You see what I mean? In case I get into a hive like that, you see, I can exchange the comb and still make my starts. These are these plastic nooks, okay? Now what I did here is I have another yard. I moved these plastic nooks. And I put them right on top of the hive, okay, and I open them up. Okay, the bees orientate to that spot. That bottom box is empty, okay. I can come back a day later or a week later, and if I don't have time right then, and then just drop the frames down into the permanent colony, because bees orientated to that location. They'll just come right on into the bottom. Okay, this gives you an idea how to break it. See the larva in there, and you just break that bottom third of the cell. There's $1,000 worth of bees right there. That's the cardboard new box pack. Where did you fix it? Okay, we're getting into a little different era. Are there any questions now about how to notch, when to do it, the week before swarming, 2-day-old larva, make your splits, move the old queen 2 miles away or whatever. It's hard, I understand, It took me a lot of years. This didn't happen overnight. And I'm throwing an awful lot of information at you. Okay?
When you're notching, are you making multiple notches on the same side of the frame?
Yeah. I usually do two with a hive tool. Now turn that frame around, I'll do two more.
Okay, two of them.
Yeah, on each side.
Just depending where it is.
Yeah, it don't matter where the larva is, okay? I mean, you can't do it just anywhere. Wherever the larva is, be in the corner, it could be right in the middle, it could be whatever. It doesn't matter as long as we get that cell.
When would you remove the extra
When I make my starts a week later, when I make my starts, then I put them in the boxes. You see, I can keep those in the same yard because all the root is sealed. Okay, so I have the boxes right on the other stands, and I'll just take this one goes here and this one, and I fill it up. A lot of times I'll take, if they need more bees, there's other frames in that hive with honey that have bees on them. Instead of shaking them, I just put that frame in there, and with the bees, just to reinforce, and try to even them out. I always leave the parent, the less bees at the parent colony because they're going to drift back to the parent colony. Okay, so I always put more bees on the nukes I set out because I'm going to lose some. They're going to go back to the parent colony.
So the day that you notch, you're taking the notch and putting it back in the old hive and taking the old queen out and putting it into a...
I take the old queen out and then I notch that other hive at that same time I took the old queen out.
And when you take the old queen out, you're just taking out the old queen and a frame of brood?
Two frames
of brood.
Yeah. And when you do the notching, you can leave one at the original location. So you really only got to move two hives. Okay, two other extra boxes. Because one can stay on the original location.
I have a question.
Pardon me?
When you take the queen cells and make your splits with them, why do you only want two queen cells? Why do you break down and throw away some of those?
Because they're going to fight. Okay, and you're only going to have one viable version anyway.
Okay, so you don't want them to have to tend to those extra ones?
No, I don't want that first virgin to waste all her energy destroying the other one. I want her to save her energy.
So you're doing her work for her.
Right, to go on the mating flight. Okay, you probably know already that I have a farming mentality. Okay, I was born on a big farm in South Dakota, and bees to me are livestock. Now, I love them, okay? But I'm only dispatching a queen to save the hive. Okay, I'm not. I just don't go around killing queens. You know, I don't. You might get the impression, and it's tough. It's tough for people to dispatch a queen. Okay, when they have to. You see.
One last question. When you're making these, it's not necessarily always the goal to get four splits out of a hive. You're just taking maybe, you might decide two.
Exactly. There's flexibility. It's terrible flexibility here. If you only want to do one or two, you see what I mean? And keep the other one stronger. You see what I mean? You only have to split it twice if you want to. You don't have to do it the fourth time. If it's got 12 frames of brood, and I run into that, then you can make six splits. And I think Gary told me that he had a couple of hives that he made six splits out of. Depending on how much brood you have, determines how many starts you can make.
Well, it's not flexible,
the
time.
The timing isn't flexible. You've got to get that old queen out of there the week before swarming, or you might lose everything. Or you won't lose everything. You might still have that one hive, but you're not going to produce any honey. You see? Look at it this way. A hive, I look at it as voltage. A hive is just so much voltage in it, okay? And it depends on how you're going to direct that voltage. Either you direct that voltage off for honey production, or you, like in my case, I direct that voltage into starts, okay? You can't do both. You can't do the honey production and you can't do the start. Now, you can do one start and still run. You can pull the old queen, and most hives can afford to, in fact, it's good for them, to take two frames of brood out and prevent swarming. See what I mean? It's good for them. Now, they can spare that two frames of brood without interfering with the honey production.
Meet with the queen with it.
Yeah.
The queen with the two frames of brood.
Yeah.
For a split.
Yeah.
Can you tell us what are some obvious signs of that swarming is going to start?
Whenever you see queen cells, usually on the bottom of the cell, the frame, the bottom bar, you'll see queen cells. A lot of times, if you've got a double D, you can just open up the back and look at the underside of the top box, and if they're starting to swarm.
Like you said before, that's probably a little too late.
It depends on how advanced they are, because a swarm will issue when the first cell is sealed. So I don't even get to that point. I got that hive artificially formed before. I can always unite back later. Mm-hmm. You know, I just got to prevent that swarming. Mm-hmm. You see what I mean? You got to prevent that swarming. If you don't want to make new splits or whatever, put her aside for a while. Get the new queen mated out of that other hive, and then dispatch the old one and put them back together. You got all kinds of variabilities of this system, but however you want it to go.
So you only need 2 yards then to do splits, and you can get your main yard, and then you need 2 miles away.
Yeah, and then, you see, bees don't have any memory as far as orientation, okay? Now they do in that 1 yard. You can take a hive of bees away 2 miles, let them fly, and then the next day, bring them back to the yard you brought them from and put them in a different location, they can't remember where they were before you moved them out. Now they're put to this new location. Bees only have the memory of the last location. Okay?
So just 2 days will do that?
2 days will do it. You got to make one, they got to orientate to another spot, and then you can bring them back. And that's all migratory beekeepers do. You're a different farming and stuff like that. They move from yard to yard to yard and keep orientating all the time. So yeah, you can move them, but they gotta orientate to another spot, then they will forget where they were that last time, and you can bring it back. We're getting into some overwintering things. You can cut me off whenever you want, okay? I'm kind of half done. So we talked about the making of the stars and etc. And I'm trying to go pretty good, but we're covering a lot of territory. When I started keeping bees 40 years ago, all I had to worry about was food with breaking ventilation. Okay, you need enough food or the hive will die over the winter. You need good wind breaks because you can have good hives and put them right out in the middle of the wind and probably lose them. Okay, it's just too much stress. A good woods or a good building or, you know, a good windbreak. And you need ventilation. Moisture kills bees, okay? The heat comes up, and if they don't have good ventilation, it'll condensate on the hive, and you can get water dripping down, and that will kill bees. I found that cold does not kill bees. They overwinter bees in Alaska and Peace River way up there in Canada. Cold does not kill bees as long as they got food. Okay. But those three are the big ones. Food, windbreak, and ventilation. Now since then, beekeeping became very, very difficult. Okay, because the tracheal came in and the varroa came in. And everybody lost their lives. Okay, all the feral colonies died, and it was tough times, okay? We also started getting viruses. We always had Nosema, but now we got that new Serena Nosema. So I've been able to handle this by breaking into my breeding cycle and outbreeding them, okay? The viruses and the Nosema, I think, are results of stress. Now, most people and most magazines you read, everybody seems to say you lose your bees by viruses and the Nosema, okay? Now, I think that's an absolute 100% true statement, Okay. But why did they get the virus? They were stressed out either by a varroa or some other outside agent, you see. It's like AIDS, okay? People with AIDS, it affects your immune system. Nobody ever dies of AIDS, they die of pneumonia. Okay? Pneumonia is the manner of death. AIDS was the cause of death. And I think that all the viruses and stuff that we're seeing, all the viruses and stuff in the SEMA buildup is a result of some other outside agent or the stress that other things are being put on the hive. The bees just can't handle that. Okay? And the small hive beetle, I want to touch on that real shortly. Whenever you do your starts, never give more drawn comb to that start than what the bees can take care of. The bees can handle the small hive beetle if you don't give them too much comb. If you give them a whole box of drawn comb on top of the start, that hive beetle will get in there and start laying eggs in the protein of the cocoon and outbreed that start, you know, just contaminate it. So that's the way I've been handling the small hive beetle.
You have them in Michigan?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I'm sure you got them here. Okay, and I hate them. Okay, and move further out away. And that's the way I've been handling them. Okay, and I use traps too. You know, I mean, I use a trap for small hive beetle. But I found that if I can keep it, if they need more, then I give them another comb. Or, you follow what I mean? That's the way I've been handling the small hive beetle. Now, I've been able to keep bees. Let's face it, the last 10 years have been tougher for me. I told you I used to just winter 3 out of 4 out of those overwinter July starts. That's been getting tougher, and the last year I lost 2 complete yards. But I lose those in October, November, and that's abnormal. Look, you don't lose bees in there. And the culprit right there, I believe, is soybean dust and corn dust. Now, I told you, I'm a farmer, and my relatives are still farmers. And I want to find some common ground, okay, of how... Go to Google, okay, go to Google and type in soybean dust or corn dust. Here's 2 articles. Human health concerns, grain dust and mold during harvest. Okay, this isn't something I'm bringing up. Okay. This is a real problem. There's been 26 deaths, or human deaths, of allergic to soybean. There's regulations in granaries and even the combines now. You have ventilations that are air filters in them. Okay. Soybean dust is detrimental, and so is corn. Okay, here, and it's just interesting because the EPA, there was a huge hearing on the EPA on the appeals court just recently, and this I just downloaded. No farm dust ruling coming from EPA. Okay, now that was October 31. 2011, that's just a couple days ago. I just downloaded it, okay? There's so much money in corn and soybean right now. It's a multi-million, billion-dollar business, okay? And soybean dust, I think bees are allergic to it, okay? And I can't handle that. You can lose your food force. I don't know how to handle other than to find some common ground. Maybe they're increasing soybeans and corn. I see corn used to be picked. They used to pick it and then bring it to the farm and then put it in your dry ground feed or store it in bins or whatever. But now even corn is combined. Okay, they shell it right in the field. And I've got pictures where there's ducks coming down here from Massachusetts, you know, across Pennsylvania and Ohio. There's combines all over the place right now, combining corn and soybeans. And that dust is all over. 100 yards behind these combines. You see. Okay.
That was for miles.
Pardon me?
Miles.
I got to tell you this, okay? When you go back and check my website, you can download that book in its entirety, the IMN's Methods of Queen Rearing, System of Queen Rearing. When I developed this method, I originally was killing larvae with flour. You know, I put the Q-tip in there and the bullet. I can kill bees with flour. I can kill all the larvae in the hive with flour. I can just put flour in my smoker, go to a hive, and just give her a couple really good shots in there, and I've killed every open larva in your hive. Okay? I've worked with this stuff. Okay? And it kills bees. Now, people will say, I've lost my best hive, my best, strongest hive. Why would I lose my best one? It's because that hive has got the most foragers. It's bringing in more, if it even makes it back.
Mel, yeah.
I think it's the CCD.
Is research saying that it's the dust or the GMO?
That's a whole other issue. I don't really haven't even got in to the herbicides that and the neonicotinoids now that they're putting on the seeds.
I just asked that because somebody else I know in this area who was into the bees is not a member of this club, but he started losing bees when his tenant farmer started raising GMO soybeans. And, you know, he noticed that the hive that made the most honey that fed off of that, he killed every comb that he fed that honey to. And, you know, he kind of is questioning that still.
Oh, yeah. And I question it, too. Okay. I'm talking about soybean ducks. Okay. And I'm talking about corn ducks. And I'm talking about those spiracles on the honeybee. That's how I killed with the flower. When that bee is laying on that royal jelly, 10 of the spiracles in that larva are on the royal jelly. It's only breathing out of the other 10 on the other side. When I shook that flower into the comb, I suffocated that larva. There's no way. And I don't think that the honeybee trachea, and I used to do some dissecting on the tracheal mite, the honeybee's trachea is not big enough to handle this load that they're getting from the ducks. I think that they're already dead before a lot of them get even back. But not only that, but even if it lands on all the plants around the field, you can't get away from it. Okay, so now they'll come in there and take pollen off the aster and goldenrod or whatever, and I'm sure that that's what CCD is. It's colony collapse disorder. They just can't handle it. And I don't know how to handle it other than to move in isolation. And I've been trying, I got bees in isolation right now. And I don't know if anybody here has seen a contraction of hives now within the last week or two. You know, I know there's a little cooler weather now and they're going to contract anyway. But, you know what I mean? Very, very serious problem. And so, like I say, just go to Google, hit soybean dust, corn dust, and even hit soybean allergy. Okay, huge problem that they went over. And not only that, but I outlined, underlined a little thing. It says, the court says EPA made its case that farm dust is likely not safe. EPA knows this. Our people that are supposed to and were commissioned to protect us, there's just so much pressure. You know, I'm a farmer. I want them to make a living. Okay? I'm also a beekeeper, and I'm also another type of farmer. that I want the blueberry people and the almond people to also make lemons. And they need bees for it. So we've got a huge conflict here, and where can we find the common ground? Now, immediately I say, well, maybe they should harvest corn and soybean at night, or they should harvest it under 40 degrees. You know, I think we could save half the bees that way. But here's another one I download. Hypersensitivity due to occupational inhalation size of contaminated corn dust. It gets in your lungs. You're allergic to it. So you pick up a lot of stuff. Another thing, and this, I'm speculating. Since the early 90s, I'm talking about infant autism, you know. This is a whole different area, okay? And the graph steadily increases, okay? And it's been blamed mostly to the vaccinations now of babies. A lot of mothers now won't get their babies vaccinated because they think that's the infant autism. And an alarming thing that I've noticed now in the last couple weeks is that vaccination and that infant autism has the same timeline as the increase of soybeans in the United States.
Soybean harvest.
Harvest, the same. Well, I don't know about being harvest, but the effect of how many per 100 kids now are getting treated for autism symptoms, and it might not be the vaccination at all. I'm just throwing it out, I'm not making any accusations, but if dust will just do it, now these people are putting these seed treatments on the seeds of soybean and corn, and not only are we dealing with the dust, but now we're dealing maybe with insecticides that are being thrown all over the place, and herbicides being thrown all over the place, and the farmers can't contain it on their own lands anymore. You see what I mean? So I don't know where this is all going to go, but I think we've got, the EPA is aware of it, everybody's aware of it, these people in the know are aware of it, and they're not telling anybody. Okay?
Mel, real quick, what's your thoughts on sugar dust and the powdered sugar dust in your hives? Some of us have been doing that.
Sugar dust?
Yeah, there's the powdered sugar dusting for mite control, just to clog up the suction cups.
I don't like it. If number one, it's laborious, going through the whole hive and messing up the sugar, the bees and stuff. There's no question that powdered sugar will knock the mites off, okay? But when I've been doing this now, I've been keeping my hives where I've been able to keep them surviving over the winter.
It seems like it's dangerously close to flour and everything.
I don't like it. You're right. But they can clean up sugar faster than they can clean up the because I have tried that with sugar, powdered sugar, to kill the larva, and that does work, but it doesn't work as well as flour. They'll get in there, and the other bees will clean up that powdered sugar quicker than they will get at that flour. That flour just gums it up, and I think this is the dust that we're talking about. Now this is a real funny slide. Okay, but I had to put it in there because when I was a little kid, I said, Mom, where's my other shoe? And she says, keep looking. Everything's got to be someplace. Okay, and that's what I'm talking about with this dust. This soybean dust and corn dust, everything's got to be someplace. Okay, and when, you know, point well made. Everything's got to be something. That's what it looks like. I snapped these pictures just before I came here, October 17th. Harvesting soybean right off by my ivy hives. The ones I didn't get out of the isolation. This is aster. This is 2 days before that. See the soybean field in the back? Goldenrod is just starting to go out now. The aster, overwintering peppery starts in the fall because soybean and corn harvest boys poisonous dust run across and they kept large area of land. See the asters in the foreground? There's another one. Caught that bee flying in the air. You think those bees don't fly across that field?
Good shot.
Guess what? I got one right on an aster bloom. And not only is she on the aster bloom, she's got her pollen basket full of aster pollen. Where do you think she's going to bring that? Now, if that field was cut the day before, that aster would be full of that stuff. Same bee. Got to look real, real close here. It's not a good shot. But you see this triangle, a little green triangle here? A little white green triangle? That's a butterfly skipper. See these little skippers flying around? We're losing a lot of our insects, not just honeybees. Okay, we're losing them all over. What I'm showing you here is the skippers feed on asters. Not only that, but I've seen bumblebees, I've seen ants, I've seen everything working asters in the fall. Move your bees to the cleanest, most biotech-free location you can find. Because I think that of what I've seen, now with the 2 yards I lost last year, completely wiped out, that was not normal. That was a pesticide, a chemical, an overdeal. 3 out of the hives in that 1 yard were gone. Like CCD. The other ones were affected so bad they lost their fuel force and struggled and everything was dead by Christmas. I moved them. I moved mostly biotech up north. There's one field that's about, this guy's a farmer. Okay, he says, you know, bring these up there. It's a beautiful location because it's to the northwest, right straight back. There's a hill behind it. That wind comes up over the hill. I got wind breaks, you know, from the trees and that. That wind is coming up over and missing the hives. It keeps going lower, so there's good drainage. There's good drainage for moisture. And there I am behind that yard. Oops. Okay, here's another one. I gotta be careful for bears. Got bears here?
No. Not yet.
You don't want bears here. Okay, and sugar bricks, candy bricks. There's one where I didn't use the excluder. They love it. And like I say, I'm keeping the protein out of them, okay, as much as I can. Another yard. We'll be wrapping those with tar paper, just to give them a little extra windbreak. We've got quarter inch or half inch holes in the candy boards on top.
Do you use 30 weight or 60 weight?
Tar paper.
I think I use the heaviest. I don't think the tar paper really helps a whole lot other than another windbreak.
Yeah, windbreak.
Yeah. The black or whatever, a lot of people say, well, the drugs, the sun or whatever. I think it's more for a windbreak. In other words, you get another airspace a little bit in between there. These here, I've got them out of the soybean grip before, so.
See, they're on pallets. You move yours around on pallets?
I don't move them
or
on pallets.
You just store them?
I just put them on a pallet. Actually, those other ones, I made little stands. I can put two, it's made by 2x4s, and I can set two of them right on there. That's just a mile or so from Lake Michigan. Trying that right off the lake there.
What would be the first symptom that I could notice if corn and bean dust was affecting my hive?
I think that you would see less bees in the hive.
5 days after I see a field harvest?
Yeah, okay, because I think it will get the field first.
So if I'm being affected by that, I should be able to figure out if that's the cause by checking them either right before that field that harvest or right after?
Yeah, I got a phone call this afternoon from somebody in Michigan that, because we're keeping track of this now. And they said they checked that 1 yard, and that 1 yard was definitely contracted. It was doesn't have the seam of bees it had before.
And the longer the drier condition that exists, after the harvest, the longer it's going to last.
One nice rain. Some people say, well, I don't get affected. I got my bees by corn or whatever and snap. And I think it all depends on the direction of the wind. It depends on, not everybody's going to get hit, okay? And this is what makes it so hard to really, really pinpoint it. You see what I mean? But by pulling things off the internet, when you have human death that will die within an hour of an allergic reaction, and by looking at what I know and about my past research, I'm killing bees with flour. That trachea, that honeybee, is not very big. Okay, and it's not using the spiracles no more that did on the abdomen when it was a larva. It's only got one big trachea coming in underneath the wing here on both sides. And I think once that's plugged, that's just like shooting a pheasant out of the air. They just can't get any air no more. They're just suffocated. And I don't think they even get back to the hive in a lot. And I think that's where you're losing your fuel force. And if it's a minor dusting, you might only lose half. And you might be affected because bees have a grooming behavior. Even if that bee didn't die, when they come back and they got dust over their body, just like the powdered sugar stuff, they'll groom it until they clean it up. There's a question.
We have some cropland that is planted every year with soybean corn, and we were wanting to pull that out and just plant something else and just leave it go natural, but what would you recommend?
I don't, like I say, I think that you can pick soybean dust from 2-3 miles away. You see what I mean? I think it's in the air. I think it's just like a pollen count when you get into spring. Some people are allergic to grass pollen or oak pollen or something like that. I think it's everywhere. I think, look at it this way, okay? You have a house and you got a furnace, and you ever pull that filter up, now your house is clean. We don't really have to get into this. Just a small scale sugar bricks, if you do 10 pounds at a time, you can do it on your stove in the kitchen, okay? These little dog food containers, these cans, that's what those are. You put some little wax paper in there, okay? You can get 5 pounds in each one. If you want to do a big one, then you have to use a fryer. Turkey fryer, and that's what we use, because you need to get that to 242 degrees. Most stoves can do a 30-pound batch at 245, so they can do 10 pounds at a time. You see what I mean? And to make your own sugar drinks. time too bad, only 2 hours.
Hey, what I'd like to...
Have you been looking into the small hive beetle any to see what you can do about that?
I haven't had the time really to get into that. My quick fix now is keeping my hives contracted, you know, so that I don't give them any more comb. I noticed the ones that had more extra comb on were the worst affected. You see what I mean? So I use the traps. If I ever get time, I would definitely like to solve that problem too. The problem I have with miticides, and I know that people can use them and et cetera, and I don't, like I said, tell you how to use them. The problem with miticides to me is that it kills the small the grower, and it kills the small hive beetle, okay, and it kills the tracheal too, okay. Now all three of those are invertebrates, okay. Now, what do you think of honeybees? That's an invertebrate too. And so I think that you can give them too much of that, but they also can die from viruses in the semen because you put an extra stress on them. You see, and so one thing about this medication is that there's no way to govern it. Okay, because of temperature, hive strength, you're giving the small hive the same dose as the big one, and I don't know. I don't really want to go there. I really haven't done a whole lot of research in that area. I am interested in that area, but I think if you keep your bees strong and just the comb reasonable where you take care of it, I think that you're fine with a small hive bee. Okay, and I've been able to break the mite's breeding cycle, and I've been able to keep my bees alive doing it the way I have for the last few years.